Since the start of the pandemic, you may have seen headlines like this. There are various alternative terms for creative industries, culture industries, creative sector, but they all refer to a global economic sector that achieved prominence in the late 20th century and has been celebrated since for rapid growth and for wealth creation and even urban regeneration. It was originally defined by the 2001 UK Labour governments as referring to the industries associated with the arts, so museums, galleries, and so on, and also design, publishing, fashion. And later definitions extended it, even to include the information economy. The common features across the different definitions are an emphasis on creativity and innovation and on people using their talents to pursue individual career paths. Workers in the sector are often self-employed or running their own small businesses, micro-enterprises. So the sector is associated with new forms of employment as well as new kinds of work. And many creative workers use the possibility of digital technologies as well. So blogging, vlogging, using an online shopfront in order to sell things they make. There is some overlap with the gig economy, but that's more about platform-based working and less about creativity and innovation. Well, the creative industries were very hard hit by the 2008 financial crisis, the global financial crisis, and also by the austerity policies that followed in quite a lot of countries, including the UK. And now it seems that they're going to be hit again by the pandemic. The creative industries have been extensively studied by academics, but not so much by psychologists, although psychologists are very interested in creativity and in creative processes and modelling those to see how they can be made better. But in this lecture, I want to take a different approach to creativity from psychology, from critical discursive psychology, and I want to look at the idea of creativity. Critical discursive psychologists would point out that psychology influences what it supposedly studies through ideas. Psychological knowledge shapes the way that we view ourselves and our problems, our assumptions about how our lives will proceed, the reasons we're having problems, the ways that we should solve problems. Psychological knowledge becomes part of common sense, the ideas that we take for granted without questioning them. And as a further complication, the discipline of psychology is itself influenced by common sense, and that is particularly relevant to creativity. So in this lecture, I'll be reviewing some ideas from psychology that have contributed to the identification and celebration of the creative industries, directly and indirectly. And I'll look at one psychological theory of subjectivity, the experience of being a person, and what that might indicate about the future of the creative industries after the pandemic, a creative legacy. Perhaps the strongest common sense idea about creativity is that it's linked to art, especially the European traditions of painting and sculpture that are sometimes called the elite or high arts. The ultimate image of a creative person is probably an artist, although we also tend to think of writers and musicians and even scientists as creative people. The image of the artist has been described by the sociologist Howard S. Becker as a person with special gifts who's not expected to follow normal social rules. The artist is allowed to violate rules of decorum, propriety, and common sense everyone else must follow or risk being punished. And so we have the caricature of the artist in the garret, living in semi-squalor, focused completely on the next great work. It's the image of an elite nonconformist. And we could also add that it's usually a male person, especially a white European or Anglo-American male person. Now, Becker doesn't claim that artists are like this. He calls the image a romantic myth. But there's an interesting argument that this idea of the artist as the ultimate creative person prompted psychology's interest in creativity. Sarah Brouillette has suggested that in the USA after the Second World War, there was a view that future economic development would require creative people because they wouldn't conform. They would innovate. They wouldn't just be rule followers. The psychologist Abraham Maslow proposed that self-actualization, people fulfilling themselves, involves creativity, and he suggested that the same creativity could be useful for business. In 1949, the president of the American Psychological Association called for psychologists to study creativity. Another writer, Jamie Cohen Cole, has suggested that around the same period, creativity was seen as politically desirable. During the Cold War, there was a perceived threat to American society from ultra-conformity, blind obedience to authoritarian leaders and ideologies. That threat would be countered by people with open, autonomous minds, creative people. The psychologist who's most associated with creativity is probably Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi. He suggested that during the Second World War, the US Air Force found that many of their pilots couldn't deal with a sudden emergency. They were too much inclined to go by the book. The solution, again, was seen to be creative people, and the Air Force asked psychologists to develop a test for creativity that they could use alongside their physical tests and IQ tests for pilot recruitment. So we can see that the discipline of psychology took up the image of the non-conformist artist and the idea of creativity as a productive and positive source in society. However, Csikszentmihalyi's own very influential contribution, systems theory, actually doesn't centre on an artist-like creative individual. Instead, the theory emphasises that creativity must be understood in relation to a social context, a domain. Within the domain, there are established ways of doing things and accepted ideas. So any innovation, like, say, a creative solution to a problem, that will need to be evaluated by other people before it's accepted. So the theory doesn't regard the creative person as a gifted, isolated artist, but as an individual in context, interacting with others. Other people will decide what's creative. They'll reject it, or they'll accept it and disseminate it. Creativity inevitably involves audience and public recognition. The image of the artist would imply that creativity is a special capacity, confined to the gifted few. But that too was reinterpreted in psychology. Psychologists like Teresa Amabile, they modelled the social factors that influence creativity. Csikszentmihalyi wrote about the kind of school curriculum that might teach creativity or at least foster it if it already exists. In Cohen Cole's words, psychologists came to associate creativity with nurture, not nature, a capacity that could be cultivated. So we could say that psychology challenged the elite associations of creativity, even though psychologists still tend to cite elite figures, Van Gogh, Picasso, and so on, in the introductions to their research publications about creativity. These various, even contradictory ideas from the association of creativity with the arts and from psychology persist in relation to the creative industries and the pandemic. The elite art association has been used to suggest that the time of the creative industries is now over. People need to be more practical. On the other hand, the idea of the practical applications, the utility of creativity, has been invoked in suggestions that creative people are needed right now to help build a post-pandemic economy. And you've probably also noticed the many claims that creativity can help people deal with the pandemic because creative activities are good for mental health. The artist Grayson Perry has been particularly prominent in advocating this. And previously, he was part of a government working group that reported, "The act of creation and our appreciation of it provides an individual experience that can have positive effects on our physical and mental health and well-being." Those assumptions can be linked back to the connections that Maslow drew between creativity and a healthy, self-actualizing person. Before the pandemic, positive accounts by policymakers and some academics and workers themselves emphasized that the creative industries were offering a new kind of work. Creative work supposedly superseded the 9-to-5, the job for life, living out a secure but boring age stage career following established procedures. The kinds of work that were variously associated with Fordism, or modernism, or the post-war Keynesian state. In contrast to that old kind of work, the claim was that creative workers could be independent and autonomous, freely following their own passions, using their talents, finding fascination, pursuing self-actualization. But critics of the creative industries noted that creative work and new work more generally was likely to be poorly paid and short-term and insecure. Experience and qualifications wouldn't necessarily be rewarded. And the creative industries perpetuated inequalities. They were dominated by white middle-class people. Women were often disadvantaged because they had caring responsibilities. And more generally, women and working-class people and people from ethnic minorities were excluded because of the old elite associations and because informal networking limited opportunities to the kind of people who were already the insiders. These critics suggested that the whole idea of creativity, the artistic associations, the promise of self-actualization, was inducing creative workers to exploit themselves. They put in long hours. Because when you're doing what you love, the boundary between work and the rest of your life disappears. They worked for little or no pay. Because again, if you're doing what you love, what's the point of counting the pennies? And the criticism was that this was all to the advantage of employers and industries, not the workers themselves. In their pursuit of individual projects, their acceptance of individual responsibility, creative workers were losing hard-won employment protections. They were abandoning a less selfish, more collective culture of old-style work. They were being recruited into, accepting and sacrificing themselves to the competitive, market-driven ideology of enterprise culture and neoliberalism. Now, underlying many of those criticisms is a theory of subjectivity, the person as a self-governing subject. It's the theory that contemporary people live within authority structures, institutions, knowledge structures, many of which are underpinned by psychological knowledge. And those guide us to live our lives in certain ways, to shape ourselves into particular kinds of people. Following Michel Foucault, Nicholas Rose has called this a regime of the self. We make choices that will supposedly fulfill us, allow us to realize ourselves. But in doing so, we're disciplining ourselves to conform. The freedom to choose is an illusion. We're disciplining ourselves to serve interests that aren't our own. Well, following that theory of governmentality and subjectification, the ideas of creativity and self-actualization can be understood as part of the regime of the self. Angela McRobbie suggests that the romance of creativity is promulgated through university courses and mentoring schemes and reports and TV programs that particularly target young people, especially young women. George Morgan and Paris Nelligan call it the creativity hoax. They suggest that mundane occupations are talked up as creative, and that the ultimate effect is that young people are forced to do bad work to serve the interests of the neoliberal economy. Creative subjects are neoliberal subjects. Christina Scharf takes the argument even further, suggesting that creative workers discipline themselves not only to work hard, but also to stay positive and deny difficulties and inequalities. Subjectification goes beyond behaviour and actions. It shapes the psychic life of the neoliberal subject. So for all these critics of the creative industries, the idea of creativity functions very negatively. But that theory of the person in relation to the creative industries, and more generally, can itself be criticised. For instance, Lisa Downing argues that writers like those ones that I've cited conflate neoliberalism, individualism, and selfishness in a very simple way, an oversimple way. She suggests that a collective focus isn't necessarily better than an individual one, and self-interest can be sometimes appropriate even, especially for women. John Clark has criticised theories of governmentality more generally because they tend to imply that subjectification is always successful, even though the original theory postulated resistance. We might add that new creative workers are almost certainly aware of the challenges posed by the sector. They might also hope that they will be lucky and achieve the big break into fame and fortune. But is it appropriate to see them as deceived or hoaxed? In this final section of the lecture, I want to reconsider the creative subject from the perspective of critical discursive psychology. Critical discursive psychology was established by Margaret Wetherill, an Open University Emerita Professor. It encompasses variations, including my own work on narrative discursive psychology. The focus is still on self-making, but critical discursive psychology centres on several concepts that complicate the accounts of the neoliberal subject that I've just summarised. I'll suggest that critical discursive psychology therefore offers us some different clues about the relevance of creativity to a post-pandemic future. Well, prediction is always difficult, but I'll outline a possible creative legacy from the creative industries, whether or not the sector continues to be celebrated. Critical discursive psychologists study the processes of sense-making and self-making through the analysis of talk and other language in use. This isn't a purely linguistic exercise, like a sort of dictionary activity. The interest is in meanings in context, in meaning-making practices that include language but aren't limited to it. My own research has been with people who engage in creative practices, students, current and aspiring creative workers, and people who pursue creative projects alongside more conventional work. These people's talk about creativity and their own creative practices is charged with value and emotion, affect. Powerful associations have accrued over time through social interactions, and other associations derive from personal experience. For instance, as I've discussed, creativity is linked to art and tends to be positively valued because of that association. Think of those psychologists beginning their papers with references to Van Gogh and to Picasso. Practitioners can therefore claim a connection to famous artists, referring to the influences on their own work. But because art also retains elite associations, it can be regarded as a bit posh, or at least middle class. Depending, say, on challenges from their families, some practitioners find they have to defend their practice, for instance, justifying it by referring to its practical uses. Others make a moral claim. For instance, they refer to political projects like environmental protection that they connect their practices to. And others emphasize that the practice is therapeutic for themselves and for other people. Each of those claims has a different emotional tenor, and it presents the practitioner in a different way. It's a form of identity work. Critical discursive psychology embraces this multiplicity of associations and potential discursive functions. Unlike many theoretical and analytical approaches, it embraces untidiness. Now, we've seen that the different meanings and associations, even the patterns of words attached to creativity, can contradict each other. Elite or democratic? Practical or transcending practicality? Well, do those conflicting meanings matter? Sometimes, yes, they do. People are forced to confront the contradictions and attempt to repair them in order to present a coherent account of themselves. But often in talk and sense making, the multiple meanings are accommodated. Indeed, they can be taken up for different purposes. Critical discursive psychology considers those multiple uses without trying to pin down a single final meaning for creativity. And it also emphasizes that any big idea, like creativity, like art, isn't inevitably positively or negatively effective. People are perpetually engaged in negotiating meanings and taking them up or testing them, utilizing them for different functions. There's no final point. As the context keeps changing, different meanings will emerge or re-emerge. In this lecture, I've sketched one trajectory of changing ideas about creativity. From its connection to the fine arts, the elite arts, as the gift of a few special people. And then its democratization in psychology as a universal potential that can be developed through education and training and is valuable for practical applications. And then its take up by politicians and policymakers, celebrating the creative industries as a sector that offers new economic and political possibilities. To creativity as a buzzword that becomes part of a cynical hoax, the exploitation of young people in particular who want to escape from conventional work and life routines. In a recent paper, instead of this kind of overview, I looked in more detail at what creativity meant to creative practitioners themselves, a practitioner concept of creativity. This is what I found. For the practitioners, through the association with the arts, and especially the elite arts, creativity can confer specialness, the specialness of having a talent or gift, and of being different. And that can function for people to present themselves positively and to justify difference. For instance, not having succeeded in conventional education or being the black sheep of the family for some reason. Creative practice can be a way of escaping from conventional work, the 9-to-5, and also from domestic responsibilities. It transcends mundane, ordinary life. It takes people beyond work at the end of a working day or at the end of a working life that's been given over to income earning and child raising. Creative practices are personal, They're owned by the practitioner. Recognition from other people is, of course, a positive, but it's the practitioner who decides the meaning of, say, a photograph or a painting or a piece of fabric art. Other people's judgment can't erase that meaning. Yet creativity is also presented as having utility. It can be monetized as a way to make a living. And as a different kind of utility, creativity is therapeutic. Here, the emphasis is not on specialness, but on the universal capacity. Everyone is potentially creative, everyone should use their creativity, and so it's positive to help them do so by, for example, teaching a creative practice or by running a workshop in it. That becomes a way of giving, of helping people. And it contrasts with the potential selfishness of pursuing the practice for yourself. So with all these different meanings embraced, in a post-pandemic or a perpetually pandemic world, what will be the function of creativity, the legacy of the creative industries? If there's an economic bounce back, perhaps the creative industries will be celebrated again as a site of economic growth and social possibility, as it was before 2008. But in more negative scenarios, we can foresee other possibilities. Creative activities may provide therapy and consolation in difficult times. Most significantly, if the pandemic continues to disrupt work and home life and social life, a claim to creativity may provide a personal identity to hold onto in fragmented circumstances, a sense of who I really am, a painter, a musician, a writer, that can be owned and is therefore always available. For people struggling with precarious employment and fragmented career pathways, such a claim to creativity can offer continuity and a promise for the future. Thank you.